The final section of this presentation is getting to Hogwarts. Getting to Hogwarts. How do you get there? The attention to school links Oakeshott, Illich, and J.K. Rowling, where Illich's vineyard, his vineyard of the text, is edifying, as is his account of the monastic life of the student. Still more significant is the conscientiously non-literary effort that has been lauded at restoring reading to public consciousness by the creator of a fictional schoolboy, J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter. School is here the key. As Oakeshott quotes Sir Ernest Barker when he says, "Outside the cottage, I had nothing but my school, but having my school, I had everything." As Oakeshott himself explicates this point, there in school, the narrow boundaries of the local and the contemporary were swept aside to reveal not what might be going on in the next town or village, in Parliament or in the United Nations, but a world of things and persons and happenings, of languages and beliefs, of utterances and sights and sounds past all imagination, and to which even the dullest could not be wholly indifferent. That is Oakeshott. And such a place of learning, Hogwarts, is almost as essential as any of the other characters in Rowling's work. To see this, consider Severus Snape, which is probably not the person you thought that I would say for the ideal teacher. Severus Snape. For reasons having to do with that same place, qua teacher, and precisely owing to his rigor, he's a difficult teacher. A teacher, Oakeshott says, is one in whom some part of or aspect or passage of this inheritance is alive. Oakeshott's emphasis on the importance of the teacher as particularly learned, not as ignorant, is as key to Oakeshott's emphasis as it was to the Illich who praised his own teacher, Gerhard Lardner, like the Pierre Hadot in his Philosophy as a Way of Life, remembering his own teacher, Pierre Courcelles, when he was named to his nation's highest academy. I quote, "The teacher has something of which he is a master to impart." What's key to the particular personality of Snape, and it's unclear that the Slytherin master could have been conveyed by anyone other than the actor Alan Rickman, not only because Rickman is that good, he is, but also because Harry Potter is more film than book, in the genre of summer sequels in the Hollywood tradition, which also happens to dovetail with the school calendar, and to the way that Harry and the rest of Snape's students interact with him has everything to do with the legacy, la vie humaine itself, to which the student is, if we recall Oakeshott's understanding, the rightful heir, you're the heir to the human condition. Snape's quality as a teacher has nothing to do with whether his students do or do not like him, or whether they aspire to his friendship. Rather, it has everything to do with the subject matter about which, remember he's master of potions, Snape dramatically and dryly, to be master of potions, is also to be master of poisons, lets his students know, to their collective horror, there can be no grading curve, no leniency, less because he says so, though he does, than because of the matter itself. That rigor is, as Oakeshott writes, embodied in the teacher as one who, quote, is himself the custodian of that practice in which an inheritance of human understanding survives and is perpetually renewed in being imparted to newcomers. To teach is to bring it about that, somehow, something of worth intended by a teacher is learned, understood, and remembered by a learner. That's the quote from Oakeshott. That Snape singles out Harry and Ron and Hermione in different ways, the first pair named Harry and Ron, although of the blood, are intellectually incompetent and they hate school. But Hermione, despite being a full muggle, is not, and she likes school. And that makes it clear that Snape is a teacher. Snape is this key for reasons that have nothing to do with the storyline's ultimate denouement. He was in love. That doesn't really matter. This is a turn with existential qualities and matters for the story itself and in the volumes that make up Rowling's series. And Rowling herself obviously perpetuates a pre-existing ideal in so doing. And that is the ideal of school as such. But her reference point also corresponds to Oakeshott's specification of place when he speaks of the apotheosis of school as a place of learning. And that's where we focus on Snape, because he's actually a teacher. He knew something, and it mattered to know that same thing. In addition, there's school, where you can learn that one thing, that same thing. For Oakeshott, the idea of such a place is applicable to the university par excellence. And I quote Oakeshott, "What makes a place of learning singularizes it by its exception. What is special about such a place or circumstance is its seclusion, its detachment from what Hegel called the hic et nunc, the here and now of current living." That is the quote from Oakeshott. Thus, in the first of the Harry Potter books by J.K. Rowling, the moment everything changes is not the thunderous moment when Hagrid comes to collect Harry from his erstwhile life beneath the stairs, ensconced in an aesthetically unappealing family, a family all members of which seem to have little love for him, and all the members of which he seems not to love in turn. The key moment is the getting to Hogwarts, which, as we recall, takes some doing. Traveling through several non-spaces to a non-space named by a number apart or between, no little debt to Sherlock Holmes and his own fictional address, 221B Baker Street, Harry Potter is directed to platform 9 3/4 at London's King's Cross Station, from which he vanishes into the non-place from which to board the non-train Hogwarts Express to Hogsmeade Station, towards another non-place, the magical Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. Yet Harry also gets to Hogwarts by conventional means, a letter of admission. He's admitted, and the letter comes to him, which entitles him to membership, just by getting that letter, in a cohort and coterie. Now, there's more to say about cliques and sorting hats, about pomposity and exclusions and so on, but that's another paper. But here, what's directly related to the privilege of this election, getting that letter of admission, is the heretofore, for Harry, unimagined experience of the new friends who outfit him for his adventure, the getting of books, and in Harry's case also the getting of an owl and the love of a similarly owl-like protector, that would be Dumbledore. Wisdom is a someone, as Illich says, along with the seamless acquisition of an adoptive family of friends. Ideal parents, that'd be the Weasleys, they're much better, and ideal siblings, Ron's brothers and sisters, both aesthetically and affectively. This leads to a touch of incest at the end, but there's nothing for it. The hero never wants the smart girl his own age. It's always got to be someone younger and someone cuter, all to replace the unloved family Harry begins with. Harry, and I've elsewhere written that every girl and boy, man and woman, who reads this tale takes themselves to be Harry, the outsider, the quintessential foundling, thank you, Charles Dickens, with blood that will out, carries the obvious sign of the blood in the form of a scar. It's on his forehead there. But to say this is to say that he does not belong at his familial home. Rather, the one place he finds himself at home, where he literally, rather than figuratively, as in the case of Sir Ernst Barker cited above, has everything, is school. Harry's Hogwarts is thus rather exactly as Oakeshott says, a place apart. I'm quoting Oakeshott, where a declared learner is emancipated from the limitations of his local circumstances and from the wants he may happen to have acquired, and is moved by intimations of what he has never yet dreamed. There, as Oakeshott puts it to continue the quote, he finds himself invited to pursue satisfactions he has never yet imagined or wished for. I'm not saying that Oakeshott explicates Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, Avant la Lettre, just to use Rowling's original English title as opposed to the American title. We didn't think the English one would sell, with its own different sorcerer's alchemical illusion, Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. It's a small irony that philosophers wish to have so little to do with alchemy that they utterly misunderstand it historically. The philosophical key is Oakeshott's attention, and that's where the reference to alchemy matters, to the adept, in the same sense in which Isaac Newton can be called the last of the magicians. He was the last of the magi, the last of the magicians. Thus, Oakeshott writes of the distinct achievements of the magicians, or personages of technical genius. I quote, a Prometheus, a Vulcan, a Bessemer, or an Edison. Scholars of economics seem to have known better. I'm thinking of John Maynard Keynes and the rarely or badly read Betty Jo, Teter Dobbs, and Francis Yates too, who have almost no successors in the increasingly narrow field of the history of science and none at all in the philosophy of science, such that only historians of science like Peter Deere, or better still, like Lawrence Principe, have anything to say about alchemy that isn't a simple repetition of misconception. I thus refer to Rowling's Harry Potter, just because it's fiction, and because the usual reception of alchemy simply presupposes alchemy of a piece with fiction as such. For Oakeshott, everything exceptional and extraordinary about the place of learning like Hogwarts is its teachers. Oakeshott uses the masculine pronoun, though his meaning isn't limited. This is clear where he writes, almost, but not quite going so far as to cite Simone de Beauvoir on becoming a woman. Oakeshott writes, there is no such thing as human nature. There are only men, women, and children responding gaily or reluctantly, reflectively or not so reflectively, to the ordeal of consciousness, who exist only in terms of their self-understandings. The idea is to become human. We tend today and always to privilege the student we admire, the students for whom the university as such exists, the student we ourselves once were, Harry Potter, along with his special scar. But the relationship cannot but be reciprocal. And we cannot forget, and I conclude with this, the teachers. As my old teacher, the Canadian Jesuit theologian, Bernard Lonergan, used to repeat repeatedly to us in class, nobody teaches if nobody learns. Thank you for your attention.